It is MLB first pitch for this Tuesday, August the 6th, Wager Talk TV. Make sure you like, subscribe, and hit that bell for instant alerts so you know when this show goes up each and every weekday, normally at 11 a.m. Eastern for your viewing pleasure. But we recorded today because Dan the Man Alexander is en route back to his home studio. He'll be back tomorrow Wednesday, but I am Steve Merrill filling in for Dan here in the host seat, and I'm joined by two of the best baseball cappers at WagerTalk.com for this Tuesday, Bryan Leonard, wearing that number one ranked Guardians hat, and then Adam Trigger on his way to a Rochester, my Washington Nationals AAA team in the near future here. But Adam, we're going to get to you in a moment. But let's start with Bryan Leonard. We talked about his Cleveland Guardians actually yesterday on Wager Talk Today. And Adam Trigger, by the way, will be on Wager Talk Today on Tuesday. So you've got that coming up at noon Eastern, of course, every weekday here on the channel. But Bryan, let's get to a big game breakdown from you because your boy Adam Trigger is going to actually look at your Guardians for a big game breakdown. So I wanted to start with you first. And what game do you want to talk about, Bryan? How about we look at Phillies Dodgers? That's kind of a big game as well. Probably the biggest game on the card once again. Part two after they played last night. What are you doing with this Phillies Dodgers game? Dan Alexander's not here today, but he has to know what you're doing with it on the replay.
Well, my cat has joined me today, so that must mean that there's some underdogs out there with some value. But I am going to stick with the total in this one, Philadelphia at Los Angeles. These are two of the top three teams in baseball when facing southpaws. The Phillies have an xRC plus of 120, while the Dodgers are at 122. So both teams do very well. Both teams basically are 20% better than league average, a little bit better than that. Versus left-handers, and that's what we find tonight. Christopher Sanchez faces off against Clayton Kershaw, and the Phillies lefty has a solid 3.36 ERA, 1.28 whip on the season, but we do have some concern going forward. When you take a look at his expected batting average, it's only in the 15th percentile. His strikeout percentage is in the 28th percentile. In his only start versus the Dodgers, he went six innings and allowed two runs, so he did pretty well there. But his last two starts overall, he faced two very good hitting teams, just like the team he'll face today in the Guardians and the Yankees. And Sanchez pitched 11.2 combined innings, permitting 9 earned runs. He's already surpassed his career high in innings by 21.1 innings. And he seems to be hitting a wall. I saw him pitch against Cleveland. Cleveland was running like crazy on him, and it was really frustrated him. So I expect the opposition to really start running on the Phillies when they play them. And that is a concern, especially with him on the mound. I think he's going to struggle in this one. He's opposed by future Hall of Famer Clayton Kershaw, who takes the hill for his third start of the season for the Dodgers. And his previous two did not work out so well. He comes in with a 5.87 ERA, 1.96 whip. The LA lefty's been able to survive the past few years with lower velocity in his fastball, but it's even worse thus far. He's in the fifth percentile in fastball velocity. His games in the minors when he was pitching before he came up showed major velocity loss, and it's just not working out for him thus far. He's one of the smartest pitchers in baseball, so maybe he'll make that adjustment. He probably will in the long run, but in the short run here, I want no part of Kershaw on the mound. These are two guys I'm looking to fade here with two of the best offenses in baseball against lefties. Give me the over out in L.A. tonight.
Yeah, and of course, that line opened briefly 8 last night, went down to 7.5, and it landed exactly 8 with a 5-3 Dodgers win on Monday. Now it's priced a little bit higher at 8.5 towards the under here, but still that key number of 9 working in Bryan's favor for his over 8.5 between the Phillies and Dodgers tonight. That's the late game at 10 p.m. Eastern on Tuesday, and Bryan actually went against his Cleveland Guardians yesterday, Adam, on Wager Talk today, and he got a 10th inning 7-6 Arizona win as a road favorite. Actually, the number one team in baseball was a home dog yesterday, and I pointed this out that the Guardians going into Monday was the only team in the league, either league, over 60%. Well, after that 10-inning loss last night, nobody in baseball has a winning percentage of 60% or better. They've all come back down to earth, which is normally the case here after 162 games. Adam, very curious to see what you're doing with the Guardians big picture going forward, but more importantly, what you're doing with Guardians and Diamondbacks tonight, another one of the bigger games on the card for your big game breakdown.
Yeah, well, I agreed with Bryan yesterday, like the Diamondbacks in that spot. And going forward, I'm much higher on Arizona relative to where the market has them than I am on the Guardians. However, you know, you made the point, Steve, that, you know, teams are going to tend to, you know, come back to earth at times. And I do think that that may happen to the Diamondbacks, maybe in the next couple of weeks for a couple of reasons. So I just want to point out first, the last 21 games, they're 16-5. It's the best record in Major League Baseball. They're averaging 6.3 runs per game. That's the best mark in Major League Baseball during that span. But, you know, I think kind of an injury that's not going to get enough attention is Gabriel Moreno leaving that game last night. I believe it was a groin injury. He's elite, more so like defensively and actually like, you know, as a catcher than he is, you know, they don't rely on him for offense, but he's a very, very good defensive catcher. And I think, you know, not having him hurt, it does create a hole in the lineup because the only other catcher on the roster, I believe right now, is Jose Herrera, not someone who would be in Arizona's optimal lineup. So when you consider that, you know, right now you're probably paying like a premium for the Diamondbacks based on how well that they've been playing, that certainly hurts. As far as this game, you know, I think this is a great spot for the Guardians to get that one back last night. So I got to be honest, totally forgot Eduardo Rodriguez existed. He was someone that got paid big time in the offseason. Forgot about that, too. The D-backs gave him 4 years, $80 million. Had a really kind of quietly had a great season for the Tigers last year on what wasn't a very good ball club. I think that's probably why he's just not at the, you know, top of memory for me. But he went he threw 152 and two-thirds innings for the Tigers last year, 3.30 ERA, and he had a career-low opponent OPS, just 648. So that's how he earned that big four-year deal in the offseason. And he just hasn't pitched all year. He hurt he had a lat injury in spring training. He re-aggravated it a couple times, and suddenly here we are, first week in August, and he's making his first appearance of the season. I don't know how these clubs, coaches, players decide what to do for rehab, but I never like the ones that don't go give themselves a thorough rehab, especially when they're not starting their season until August. And so I don't see how this works out well for Rodriguez here. The only thing he's done in terms of live rehab was a simulated game last week down at their spring training complex. Didn't go pitch at Double A, didn't pitch at Single A, no Triple A, no actual live baseball, which I think you need that when you miss half of the season. And so even if he's really good, he's not going to go more than four or five innings here. He hasn't been stretched out properly. And that is a huge issue for the Diamondbacks because they're going to probably be very shorthanded in the bullpen today. By my count, they probably don't have Ryan Thompson, Justin Martinez, or A.J. Puck today, all of which have pitched in three of their last four games. I'd be shocked if Arizona uses any of those arms today. So you're looking at, you know, even if Rodriguez is good, which is questionable because it's his literal first live game action of the season, you still have to piece together five innings in the bullpen on the road without three of your top bullpen arms against a Guardians team that, you know, regardless of what I think of them from a value standpoint, they've still been one of the best teams in the league this year. You can't deny that. The other thing I can't deny, and like I said, I think Bryan and I talked about this guy last week, is Ben Lively. He has been phenomenal. He's been far better than I could have ever imagined watching this guy in the KBO for three straight seasons overseas over there. 17 of 19 starts, he's allowed three runs or fewer. He's been as consistent as they come. And, you know, the Guardians, their bullpen struggles, I think, is a short-term thing. They had gone they were so good for so long in the bullpen. They were going to have a rough patch, but I think that gets fixed. This is still one of the elite relief units in the league. So it feels like a good spot for the Guardians. I think Lively keeps Arizona's hitters off balance, like he's kept just about everyone off balance this year. And if he gets that ball to the Guardians bullpen with a lead, I think they find a way to get that one back from last night.
Yeah, we pointed this out yesterday when Bryan Leonard and I were talking on Wager Talk today that all three division leaders right now in the American League have a worse run differential than somebody behind them. It's really an incredible stat, and that, of course, applies to the Guardians. They're plus 84, but the third-place Royals are plus 91 in that own division. Orioles are actually trailing the Yankees in run differential. Mariners ahead of the Astros, who have a better run differential. So it's kind of crazy how wide open some of those divisions might be in the American League. Bryan, let's talk National League, though. Two playoff contenders right now. The Brewers are leading the NL Central. The Braves right now are actually dead even, I think, for one of the wild card spots. They're hanging on by a thread, 9 games above 500. So big game in Atlanta tonight, Bryan, with the Braves as a small $1.25 favorite. Elder Overea over the Brewers at 720 Eastern. You got any opinion in this one?
Not a lot, although I will say I am in full agreement with Trigg's play. There's three games out there that are going to run into some rain problems, and one of them is the Cleveland game. Arizona, Cleveland, the Angels and the Yankees, and San Diego and Pittsburgh are all going to have rain. The only drawback of the Cleveland game is if it gets rain early, maybe in the third inning or so, Cleveland won't have that advantage because they probably will have their starter have to leave at that point. Whereas when the Arizona starter leaves, we expect that because he's, as was pointed out, he's going to be on a pitch count. But yeah, I like Cleveland if they can get that game in. The Milwaukee game has got two guys here in Rhea and Elder who usually I'm looking to fade. And Trigg talked about, I think it was the last time we were on, how overrated Atlanta was. The line isn't overrated here. You're looking at something in the 120 range, anywhere from 122 to 129. That's a fair line here against Milwaukee, a team who's really struggling offensively lately. But the Braves are not playing well either in that regard. So I don't have much to add on this one. I'm looking to fade the Braves, but if the Lions are like they are now, we may have lost that ability in the near future.
Yeah, and Adam, I'll get your thoughts on this real quick before we hit another game. I mean, 8.5 with two mediocre pitchers on the mound, it's juiced to the over, but we are seeing some nines now. In fact, two of the leading indicator books offshore as of Tuesday morning have already moved to 9 under. So it looks like there might be a little bit of sharp over money on this one in Milwaukee and Atlanta, Adam.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense because, you know, I don't have a ton of faith in Elder or Rhea. I do like when they put Colin Rhea behind an opener. And sometimes the Brewers will come back like in the middle of the day and they'll make the pitching change and they'll put an opener out there. That would make the Brewers more appealing to me if they did that. I don't think they've done it for a couple months, but I don't know. He was great behind an opener back in like May and June. As far as the Braves are concerned, I still feel the same way about them. You know, they had their little stretch where they were, you know, winning a couple games. And now I believe it's, 15 scoreless innings after they were shut out by the Marlins of all teams on Sunday. So just I'm kind of with Bryan. I have no interest in really backing Rhea or Elder. But the team I prefer here is the Brewers. So if you're going to give me plus money on the Brewers, that's the way I would have to go. As far as the total is concerned, not a huge opinion for me.
Yeah, once again, 8.5s moving to 9 in some of the sharper books. It looks like the early money as of Tuesday morning, at least, is on the over in that Milwaukee-Atlanta game. Adam, let's move back to the American League while I've got you here. I talked about those Kansas City Royals who quietly have the best run differential in the AL Central, but they're only third in their own division. In fact, it's pretty crazy. They have the second best run differential in the entire American League, ahead of even the Orioles who are leading the East. Second best run differential in the entire American League, but they're only third in their own division. So, yes, there's probably some upside with the Royals, but the Red Sox are playing very good baseball as well. In fact, Boston's now climbed to within just a game and a half of a wild card spot, and the Royals right now are in a wild card spot. One thing that jumps out to me about Kansas City, though, a young and up-and-coming team, and as is often the case, they've been much better at home. 13 games above 500 at home, one game below on the road. They are at home tonight against the Red Sox. High-scoring game last night. Do you have anything on this one tonight on Tuesday?
I mean, I love this Royals team. I've kind of said this since the beginning of the year. I thought they were the most talented team in this division. If I was going to pick, you know, back if you went back to April, it was kind of like, okay, we knew the White Sox were going to be bad. And it was, you know, everyone was kind of Guardians, Twins. I thought the Royals, you know, far more so than the Tigers would be the dark horse in this division. I still think they could win this division. The only problem with the Royals, and we'll have to see how this plays out over the next 2 months, is I'm not sure that this team knows how to win big games yet. Meaning, like, when you get to August and September and there's games of this magnitude and there's games, you know, against a team like the Red Sox in big spots, can a team that has been just in the very basement the last few years win these big games on a nightly basis? I guess that's yet to be determined. That's the only thing that gives me a little bit of pause with them. Now that Steve, now that you're kind of being forced to lay $1.30, right? Like, this would be a totally different conversation if the Royals were still sneaking up on people. They're really not anymore. So that's where it's like, I love the makeup of the lineup. Bobby Witt, all of the underlying metrics suggest that this offense is fantastic. They hit right-handed pitching better than they hit left-handed pitching. So that certainly, is a check mark in their column tonight. But, if you're going to force me to lay -130 with them in games like this, that's where it gets tough for me, because I don't know if they have the culture of winning these type of games just yet.
Yeah, I've been saying that for a while now. You kind of wait for the Royals to fade. It's a young team, but as they get into 120, 130 games in the season with some tension and some playoff implications, you would have to think they're going to probably start to falter. But so far, they're hanging in there. And once again, they are in the playoffs as of this Tuesday, August the 6th. Bryan, I want to look at another American League game with you. Now, I talked about the Orioles. First place in the AL East, even though the Yankees have a better run differential, but they're playing the Toronto Blue Jays, who everybody thought would be a huge seller near the trade deadline. In fact, we didn't think any of the starters would even be there anymore. So I guess in that case, they didn't sell off quite as much. But we have Toronto here as a home dog against the Orioles, Rodriguez and Bissett. Orioles about $1.40 road favorite at Toronto, Bryan. Anything catch your eye on this one?
Yeah, I'd prefer Baltimore, but I think the line's a little bit too high here. I've talked about Toronto, even with the situation they've been in. They continue to play hard. Got to give them the credit in the world. And Guerrero has been one of the hottest hitters in Major League Baseball. He's just been on fire since the All-Star break. So I like the Orioles team, obviously. How do you not like the Orioles team? They're just loaded everywhere. Probably the most complete lineup, 1-9 in Major League Baseball. And I think they've got an advantage in the starting pitcher today in Rodriguez against Bassett. But I hate to lay that kind of number with the divisional rival. I'm more of an underdog player when you're playing inside a division if you can get him as a home underdog. So just I think Baltimore wins, but I'm not going to have any money on it.
That's Bryan Leonard. I'm Steve Merrill. This is Adam Trigger. You can find us at wagertalk.com. And don't forget, this week and this week only, get the rest of August for free when you buy September and October. It's a buy 3 months, buy two, get three for free. The way it works is you buy two, which is September and October, you're getting the rest of August for free. That special is good this entire week, but the sooner you get on board, you see it's good to August 11th there on the screen. Sooner you get on board, the sooner you get the rest of August for free. Look, you've missed 5 days, but there's still 26 more days of August to get for free, and that's all sports, football, baseball, basketball when it resumes in October. You're getting it all for one price. You're saving almost $300 instantly. No promo code needed. Every capper, multiple cappers, you can get several cappers. Get Bryan Leonard, get Adam Trigger, get myself, Steve Merrill. But do it this week and do it sooner than later so you get the rest of August free right now at wagertalk.com. Going to get to best bets in a moment here on the show on the way out. But Adam, I got to finish off running down these games. We talked a lot of big games, a lot of playoff teams. We got to talk about the most important game, the historical game tonight, your Chicago White Sox against Bryan Leonard's future Oakland through Sacramento Las Vegas A's. For those not following it closely, I did a standalone video yesterday, by the way, guys, on the White Sox-A's game. We had a maiden starter, usually an underdog starter who's never pitched as a catch play for me. I like using those angles. I also thought the White Sox would be motivated. But with that said, I still recommended Oakland. I said, lay the run and a half plus money or make it -1. It didn't matter. They won 5-1. Big picture, the Chicago White Sox have now lost an American League record 21 straight games. They tied my childhood Baltimore Orioles from 1988 that started the season 0-21. I remember that well. I believe Brady Anderson was on that team in center field. And now they're chasing Dan Alexander's Philadelphia Phillies for the Major League record 23 straight losses. They have 21 straight, Adam. And then, Bryan, I'll get your thoughts on the way out, too, before best bets. But what are we doing with the White Sox? I talked about it. Every team loses at least 40%, and every team in the baseball has. But normally every team wins almost 40%. The White Sox are at like 23%. They're not going to be close. They've lost 21 straight. They've tied the record. They obviously weren't motivated last night to avoid it. Yet, these lines are still very reasonable. We look at tonight's price. Oakland's only $1.85 favorite, just like last night. Any advice, not necessarily on this game, but just big picture with the White Sox, and then we'll let the cat weigh in as well.
So, listen, I was on the White Sox last night after the pitching change. I wouldn't have been on it before the pitching change because I didn't want to play plus one and a half at minus 140. The pitching change from Cannon, who we'll talk about in a second, to Kai Bush was a 20-cent move. I disagreed with that. I thought, you know, Kai Bush is someone I've liked in the minors this year. He's a top prospect. I also, Steve, I like to play against the or I like to back sometimes the last second pitching change because I know the hitters were probably preparing for Cannon. And so to get Bush kind of thrown in there was appealing to me. And then, of course, I got the White Sox down to minus 120. And really, Bush didn't throw the ball poorly. He just, you know, major league debut, a little bit of nerves, walked a couple guys. And it ended up being the walks that did the White Sox in that game. But the other thing, man, I mean, there's just right now up and down that lineup, there's very few quality at-bats, competitive at-bats. I mean, there's no reason that a guy like J.P. Sears should be able to just carve you up for seven innings, which is essentially what he did to the White Sox last night. Now, I don't think Stripling does that. And here's the thing, like this is probably the spot where the White Sox either win or cover the plus one and a half run line. I don't know if I want to get involved with it at minus 130, minus 135, but if it's all A's money all day and this gets knocked down to a reasonable price to play it at, I may just run it back with the White Sox because, again, you have to look at each event, you know, individually, right? Like, I didn't bet the last 20 games of this series, you know, of the White Sox losing streak. I think I'm 2-2 playing with the White Sox in this run. So I could really care less that they've lost that many games. And on the flip side, I don't know that the right move is to just be laying $1.90 with an A's team that's also 20 games under 500. If you're looking at the pitching matchup here, right now, John Cannon is a far superior option to Ross Stripling, in my opinion. Stripling is a guy that I feel like is, you know, maybe a 4A guy at this point in his career. You know, he missed some time being injured. I know he was pretty good last time out, but, you know, if he at this point, I think if Ross Stripling's in the bigs for a period of time, he's probably getting knocked around. Jonathan Cannon could be the ace of the future for this team. You know, he wasn't supposed to be up in the bigs as long as he's been this year, but when you're as far out of it as the White Sox, you just kind of promote guys quickly. He's been outstanding, and I actually cashed in his last start. I backed him against the Royals. I took the White Sox plus one and a half, and they lost by one. But he went seven innings and gave up one hit in that game. Just fantastic, and I think he could pitch, you know, good against this lineup again that's never seen him, you know, today or has very little exposure to him today. So today might be the day. I still would you know, the play here for me would just be to take the run and a half with the White Sox because, you know, even if they don't win one of these sooner or later, they're going to probably get a close one in there. But am I overly confident? You know, how can you be overly confident in a team that's just lost 21 straight games? But that's my take on this one.
Yeah, Bryan, and as we're doing the show here, this line is jumping. It opened as low as 165 overnight, was 185. Now it's up to 195 in some spots. So we are seeing some movement on the A's. And, Bryan, it's interesting. 16 of their 21 losses have been by two runs or more, the White Sox. So this is a team that's just really you toss the towel in the season. I'll get your quick thoughts on this when we get to best bets. But, Bryan, I mean, are you doing anything with these type of losing streaks, or are you just staying far, far away, just saying this is a team I'm not touching?
No, I look for value. I go just the opposite of just about everybody else. I'm looking to catch the falling knife, as you would say.
That's what I was going to ask you.
with the White Sox. Compared to yesterday's starting pitchers and these starting pitchers, I totally agree. The White Sox got the better starter here. Their offense is terrible, no doubt about it. But if you would have told me coming into the season that I would have to lay 195 with Ross Stripling against a high school girls team, I may not do it. it's just this is what I would call a spite bet. The pros are not looking to bet against the White Sox in this situation. They make money by betting on them, whether it be plus the one and a half or to win outright. That would be the only way I would look at it. I'm not going to put my money on it because the offense is so bad. But it would not surprise me if this is a lower scoring game here and the White Sox are competitive. Somewhat lean with maybe Oakland team total under would may be the way to go. But I can't get behind the White Sox right now.
Yeah, no, I got a good. I was going to say, I got one game you should care about. It was last night and tonight, right? Because, I mean, they still don't have the American League record, and they don't have the MLB record for fertility.
Yeah, and just to piggyback off something Bryan said, which made me laugh, stripling against, a Little League team or whatever, he's made 13 starts for the A's this year, and the A's have lost 10 of those. So, I mean, that just tells you, to make Bryan's point, you can't lay $2 with Ross Stripling. You just can't. So you have to either find a way to bet the White Sox or just find a different game.
Yeah, and I was going to say, coming into the season, I mentioned this in my video yesterday, if you told me one team was going to be on a 21-game losing streak between the White Sox and A's, I think we all would have mortgaged the house that it was the Oakland A's that had lost 21 straight instead of going 11-6 straight up, by the way, since the game before the All-Star break. They've won 11-17. They've actually played quietly good baseball. All right, enough puking on that game. The viewers hopefully are not nauseous by now, so we're going to look at some better games for best bets. And Bryan Leonard, I will start with you. And this is a pretty good one we didn't touch on during the show, but definitely want to get your thoughts on the Astros and Rangers. Should be two of the better teams. Rangers have underachieved this year, but the Astros have been coming on strong the last few months. What are you doing with this one? Around the pick'em price, we got Texas at Houston, or Houston rather, at Texas tonight on Tuesday, 8:00 Eastern.
Anytime these two get together, I want to play on Houston. They've dominated the series. The way Texas made their comeback yesterday, I think it's more reason to play Houston here. I do trust Valdez more than I trust Taylor Molly in his first start of the season. I like Molly. I really do. But guys coming off a long layoff like that, we've seen it with Kershaw. We've seen it with Cole. They just haven't been themselves. It's going to take them a while. So I would prefer the Houston team total over. The line in the game is only 8. So you probably could find a 4 out there at a decent price. Houston over may be the way I would look at this one.
Like it. Astros, Rangers over the 8. Very modest number for two teams that can put up some runs. And Adam Trigger, we're going to finish the show off with the best bet from you, my friend. And this one is intriguing because as of Tuesday morning, we're seeing the lowest total of the season. Twins, Cubs. You know, normally it's decent pitchers involved, but when you see the games in Wrigley, you don't have to be a weatherman to assume that wet wind is blowing in. When I last checked this morning, it's blowing in about 14 miles an hour from center field. We've got the lowest total of the season. So the question is, do you go under or do you go over the 6 between Minnesota and the Cubs?
Well, Steve, I think you flipped them. My best bet was for the show was the Astros. So I'm just going to give my take on that, and I'll let Bryan hammer home the Twins Cubs total, which I have zero opinion on. So Astros is my best bet for the show. They're coming off their worst loss of the season yesterday. 2-1 lead in the 8th, a 3-2 lead in the 10th, managed to give up both of those, game tying home run to Corey Seager, and then of course the game winner walk off home run to Josh Smith. Just, you want to talk about nauseating. If you're an Astros fan, that had to be excruciating to watch. They had the bases loaded, Steve, 3 times in the final 4 innings. They didn't hit a ball out of the infield, and they had 5 of their 7 at bats with the bases loaded were strikeouts. And then to have them loaded in the 10th and only get 1 and then lose on a walk-off bomb, just an absolutely horrific way to lose. And then to make matters worse, it's Ryan Pressly. And it's the new acquisition, Caleb Ferguson, that gives them up. Just, it doesn't get worse if you're an Astros fan right there. And it's kind of, encompassed what the Astros have been the last week or so. They've now lost 6 of 8. The offense is doing nothing. They've scored just 19 runs in those 8 games. But Framber Valdez has been the one consistent positive for this Astros team. They've now won 7 consecutive times he's toed the rubber. He's 5-0 with a 2.95 ERA in that span. Like Bryan mentioned, I do think the bats potentially get going here as well, which would help his cause. And one thing I really liked about Valdez, he did this in his last start against the Pirates. He was struggling. He gave up a couple runs early, and he came out and just pitched out of the stretch the rest of the game. Didn't give up a run. Started throwing curveballs. That's not something that if you've watched him pitch on a day-to-day basis that you've seen every game, and it's like – The fact that he was able to make that type of adjustment on the fly, I guess, speaks to, that he is an elite pitching option. And one that I think maybe isn't getting as much credit as he deserves this year because the Astros aren't the sort of juggernaut that they've been in past years. Now, another thing Bryan touched on, Tyler Mahle. This is his Rangers debut. Tommy John surgery last year. Now, he did have a proper rehab. He made 6 rehab appearances at all different levels. They really sort of, you know, took their time and dragged out his rehab. But, you know, the last 2 times, I watched his most recent start, with Round Rock, and the 2 starts where they let him go into the 4th or 5th inning was where he gave up the most hard contact. Now, I also think it might help the Astros that start again with Round Rock was against Sugar Land, which is the Astros AAA team, so they might have a nice scouting report on him. So for me, I don't trust Mahle in his, you know, coming back here off the long layoff. Valdez has been lights out. The Astros, it feels like they have to get this one after choking last night's away. So I lean the Astros, my best bet for the show.
That's the official best bet for the show from Adam Trigger. I inverted them. I got so excited about the lowest total of the season in that Cubs-Twins game, Bryan, that I asked Adam about it. But once again, Adam's best bet is in the Texas Rangers-Houston Astro game. He likes Houston as the small favorite. And Bryan Leonard, you're the man with a best bet on the total in this Cubs-Twins game. As I mentioned, it's the lowest total. You know, we hardly see any 6.5s, but I don't remember any time that we've seen just a 6 across the board the morning of a game in quite a while. And not surprisingly, the wind is blowing in from Wrigley, but we still need a little bit of pitching as well. So what are you doing with this one? Do you like over or under between the Twins and Cubs for your best bet?
Yeah, before we get to my best bet, I just want to point out I do have a 5% play going today. We didn't discuss this game on the show at all today. So a big 5% play, 4-1 on the season, 80% on those. The only loss was a total that I lost by 0.5 run. So I've got to bounce back from that. We've had a lot of success on these 3% and higher on the season, so that's up there right now. Yeah, let's take a look at this Minnesota Cubs game. We find 2 aces on the mound in Chicago, and Pablo Lopez faces off against Shota Imanaga. Lopez really struggled out of the gate, but his talent has shown far through thus far since then. Despite a season-long 4.65 ERA and 1.14 whip, his expected ERA is only 3.43, so he's got some positive regression coming his way, and he's in the 95th percentile in extension, 84th in strikeout percentage, and 87th in walk percentage. In 6 of his last 7 starts, he's permitted 2 earned runs or less. He's pitching very well right now, and I think he'll have a lot of success here against Chicago. Imanaga, 3.09 ERA, 1.09 whip on his rookie season here in Major League Baseball. His chase percentile is in the 98th percentile. He's terrific in that. And his walk percentage is in the 97th. He doesn't walk many batters. He's only had 3 starts all season where he's allowed 4 or more runs. That's the good part. The bad part was in those 4 starts, he allowed 24 combined runs, which has really hurt his ERA, which shows how good he's been in every other game. You mentioned the wind. Wrigley's known for its winds. Tonight, the average winds will be coming into home plate at 28 miles per hour. We've got 2 pitchers who don't allow free passes. I find it hard to see either team putting up crooked numbers here. Yes, the total 6. We rarely see a 6, but I like the under here. I don't see a single ball getting hit for a home run and 2 great pitchers that don't walk batters. Under 6 between the Cubs and the Twins.
It's Bryan Leonard's free play best bet for the show today on Tuesday. Twins and Cubs under the 6 runs at 8 o'clock Eastern. But once again, if you want Bryan's strongest play of the night, perhaps his strongest play this week, a rare 5% client best bet for Tuesday night, a game we did not talk about here on the show at wagertalk.com. And, of course, Adam Trigger's going with the Astros as a $1.15 small road favorite for his free best bet for the show. And if you want Adam's strongest best bets tonight for Tuesday, check him out also at wagertalk.com. And I'm Steve Merrill. Dan Alexander will be back tomorrow, Wednesday. Don't forget, I'm doing some free play videos each and every day. Also have a free play video on Brazil, USA, the men's basketball Olympic quarterfinal. I'll also be doing both semis and the bronze and gold medal games. So I've got your men's Olympic basketball covered with free play videos, daily baseball videos. So hit subscribe and hit the bell for instant alerts here on Wager Talk TV. And don't forget, you get myself, Steve Merrill, Bryan Leonard, Adam Trigger, any and all cappers you want, get August for free. When you buy September and October, it's 3 months for the price of 2, and it's available right now. No promo code needed at wagertalk.com. Thanks for watching. Don't forget, we're on every weekday, Monday through Friday, 11 a.m. Eastern here at MLB First Pitch. And then, of course, Wager Talk today is at noon Eastern here on Wager Talk TV. Thumbs up, like, and comment below. We read all the comments and we reply back. Enjoy the games tonight on Tuesday. We'll talk to you again soon here on Wager Talk TV.